While we'll be starting with the Stravis music or the Stravismus IC and the surge on session. So we want your surge to be on. You have had a very nice evening and cultural program, and you had lots of music too. But now it's the music of a different kind, which gives us pleasure as well as the patient. So we will have a session on Stravismus surgery mainly, and the different surgical approaches that we have. One by one, we have a galaxy of speakers here, starting with Dr. Digvijay Singh, who will be telling us about the recession component. And then we have Dr. Swati, then Dr. Jitendra, Rohit, and Abhijit Rasal to assist me in giving a bit of Stravis music to you, all of you. So I think we start with the first session of the thing, and we have to start with the recess. So the recession has to begin.
Good morning, everybody. I thank Professor Pradeep Sharma for giving me the opportunity, and I hope to take you through a procedure which is fairly common. In fact, everybody should be aware of it. Everybody should be in a position to do it, ideally, and it's something that's not very difficult. It's the recession surgery. And we're starting with a recession here, right in the beginning. Recession is a weakening procedure for the muscles. We do recessions for the recti muscles, essentially the medial rectus, lateral rectus, the superior and the inferior rectus. There are recessions also done described for the obliques, but they're a little different. I'm focusing here essentially on the rectus muscle recessions and a few variants of the same. It's a weakening procedure. Every recession in the different muscle gives a different amount in each in terms of the result from that procedure, the amount of weakening. And that normally over time, one surgeon can form his own nomogram as he's aware. But these are the general values that are there for a particular amount of a recession. And there are certain minimum and maximum that are described for various forms of recessions. And these are easily available to you in any of the texts. And you can actually make your own tables now for the final results. Here we're doing a fornix-based recession. As you can see, a cotton traction suture has been placed and is being held by assistant. Now we made a fornix incision about 8 millimeters away from the limbus. We have hooked the muscle, both the conjunctiva and the tenons is cut. The muscle has been hooked with a Jensen hook, then with a Green hook. Now we are reflecting away the tenons here so that we can expose, we can make sure that the hook is entirely through the muscle. There are certain tests that are described to make sure that you've got the entire muscle and not partly. An incision is, nick is made here to expose the full tube and the full muscle. And here you can see how the assistant is holding the hook and the surgeon is now dissecting the adhesions around the muscle, and the intermuscular septum is visible. And here you can see with these two lens hooks or graphase hooks that you could use, you're reflecting away the tenons and making a dissection. Now we use a 6-0 Vicryl suture to pass imbricate through the muscle here. And this is a cut suture. First, we're going full thickness through the lateral third or so of the muscle, passing it out through the edge, and then repassing it again in that lateral third and taking an interlocking bite of the suture. And we tie a knot here to make sure that the suture holds on well. It's very important to have a full thickness bite there so that you have a good grasp of the muscle fibers. And the same thing, the procedure is repeated on the other end of the muscle here. And you can also do it sometimes with a double-armed 6-0 Vicryl suture, as you please. Here we are now disinserting the muscle from the insertion. It's very important to make sure that you don't cut the sutures at this stage. Then a pre-decided value, it's important that you have a pre-decided value for how much you want to recess, and that is marked here with a gentian violet dye using a caliper. And now the Vicryl sutures are passed through the sclera. This is now a partial thickness passage through the sclera, and the needle should be visible throughout the passage so you don't risk perforating the sclera. This is a stage where I often zoom in and magnify a little bit and do it carefully and slowly. And because then you are tying the two 6-0 Vicryl ends here, as you can see. And it's important that your knot should be tight. We don't want the muscle to just get lax or hang behind, and that'll change the amount that you decided. Make sure it's parallel to the original insertion, as you're seeing here. But there are variants where you can have a slanting insertion as well. But most of the times, it's important to make sure that it is parallel to the original insertion. Here we are cutting away the sutures now. Always do a force duction test once before you close and after you close. Now we are doing an end-to-end apposition of the conjunctiva here using 8-0 Vicryl sutures. This is also an important step. You don't want any tenons to be prolapsing through. It should be an end-to-end apposition for the best cosmetic results. And that completes the fornix-based recession. You can also do it through a limbal incision, where you can give an incision here and then make a flap and reflect the entire conjunctiva and the tenons backwards. There are certain variations that are there to a recession. This is a recession with a downshift. Sometimes you have to do an upshift or a downshift to correct patterns. Here, if you can see that this is just the end part of it where we've reinserted the muscle. Compared to the original insertion here, you can see that this insertion is downshifted and about by half the muscle length, as I'm pointing out here. So this is done to, here it was the lateral rectus being done to correct a V pattern, an A pattern. You can also sometimes do another form, which is a hangback recession. This has been done here, where for some reason you're not even able to pass these sutures through the sclera at the point where you want to reinsert them behind. Let's say there's a band going on there, or there's some fibrosis, or there's, for some reason, the sclera is very thin. Then you can pass these sutures through the original insertion here, and the muscle is going to then hang back from those sutures and will, over time, insert at approximately the space where you, at the place where you have pre-decided for it. So here, the important thing to note is that you've taken a separate mark and the knot is being tied up. So you'll see how the assistant is going to hold that area with the forceps, which we have already marked out in terms of millimeters. And then you take a knot onto that because the knot is now what is going to hold back. So it should be you take a double or triple knot here, extra knot. And once that is done, you see how the muscle is now behind on the sclera, exactly at the place where you want it. So this is a hangback recession. Sometimes you can do a hemi-hangback recession, whereby you can pass it closer to the sclera rather than have to hang back by the entire length of whatever 6 to 7 millimeters that you're recessing. You could probably hang it back by 2 or 3 millimeters passing through that portion of the recession. So I think this pretty much covers recession. There are a lot of other things, like there is recession with Farden and all, but for the want of time, I'll stop here. And that's what...
I think we'll start with the recession. Session, because that is the most common strabismus procedure that all of you must be doing. How many of you are already performing surgery, a proper technique? Whether if you are a beginner, you can start with a limbal incision, and if you are more confident about the anatomy, then you can proceed to the fornix incision, which is a smaller incision surgery. And you have to be precise in going the subtenon space. You have to be good in your hooking so that you do not rupture the sheath of the muscle, you do not rupture the muscle, and as far as possible have a bloodless surgery. So squint surgery also is mostly bloodless if you are taking care of the proper technique. I think Dr. Digvijay has shown you some of the videos of how we can do with this. We will have more discussion at the end. I would request all of you to keep your questions so that we have in the panel discussion at the end. Now we move on to the second procedure, that is resections. And also a newer thing which keeps coming and going is the plication procedure as a strengthening procedure. So both of these I will request my colleague Dr. Swati to tell how we can manage resections and the applications.
About not just resections but plication also. So strabismus is all about balance. So once you have a recessed a muscle or weakened a muscle, you also have to strengthen the other muscle to reach the ortho position. So there are various strengthening procedures, as we know. There is resection, advancement, tucking or plication or transposition. So I'll be mainly focusing on resection as well as plication. So resection is the most commonly performed surgery as a strabismologist, as sir has rightly mentioned. It acts by strengthening the length, by shortening the muscle by excision of the shortening the muscle by excision. So it increases the length tension curve and thus the muscle is shortened. So once the muscle is shortened, the tension in the muscle increases and it gets strengthened. But then it has its own limit. So once you keep on cutting the muscle, you reach a limit. The limit is where the tendon ends. So if you cut the muscle beyond that, then it's basically a myotomy and it will weaken the muscle. So there are limits of resection also. So for medial rectus, it's around 6 millimeter, and for lateral rectus, around 9 millimeter. And we have to do our resections within this limit. So this video shows... So this video shows a resection performed through fornix incision, as Dr. Digvijay has rightly described that how to hook the muscle, to isolate the muscle with the various Green's hook, Jensen's hook. There's a cutting of intermuscular septum and all its attachment. Then you measure the point desired amount of resection which you have to do. You pass a full thickness bite, and because we are using a double arm sutures, two double arm sutures, so the two sutures are passed at each end. The muscle is then clamped, cauterized, and cut. The stump is also cut, and the needles are then passed through the original insertion. So taking two double arm sutures at each end makes it more stronger, so the chances of loss of muscles are less, and there may not be any central sagging. This is how we close the conjunctival position with 8-0 vicryl sutures. But yes, resection has its own disadvantages, two major disadvantages. Because we cut the muscle, we are also sacrificing the anterior arteries. Thus it limits our surgery to two recti. We cannot operate more than two recti at the same sitting. Otherwise, it will lead to anti-segment ischemia. The another major disadvantage is while cutting, there are chances, especially if the full thickness bites are not taken, there are chances that there may be a lost muscle or a slipped muscle, which is irreversible. It has been seen that anterior-segment ischemia is more common after the disinsertion of three or four recti. But yes, it has also been reported if only two recti muscles have been cut. So therefore, an alternative in form of plication comes very handy when you want to operate upon more than two recti at the same sitting. Plication is also known as double breasting or tucking or cinching. It effectively shortens the length of the muscle but without cutting the muscles. We have to plicate the muscle, fold the muscle in fact. It has advantages, or whatever are the disadvantages of recession are advantages of plication, that since vessels are spared, the risk of anterior-segment ischemia is less. There's practically no risk of lost muscle, and in initial stages it can be potentially reversible. It was reported as early as in 1883, and it has various modifications like muscle-to-muscle modification or muscle-to-the-sclera modification. So this diagram shows muscle-to-muscle kind of plication where, you know, after hooking the muscle, the sutures, both the ends of the sutures are passed through the muscle itself and causes a kind of folding of the muscle on itself. So this is muscle-to-muscle plication. Then there is muscle-to-sclera plication also. Once you have taken bite from sclera, the final bite is from muscle, the final bite is taken from sclera. And thus the folding comes anterior to the at the level of insertion. So this is a muscle to sclera plication. So this is a video showing medial rectus plication through fornix incision. Chalni hai. So yes, once you have isolated the muscle on the muscle hook, you take the mark at the desired point and you pass the sutures. Again a full thickness.
You both can come here. Swati can also join. Have more space also.
So sutures are passed at the desired point. You can again use double arm sutures or single arm sutures, depending on your preference. Then the advantage, which we have already explained, that you don't need to clamp or cut the muscle. You can pass the sutures directly through the insertion. This is muscle to sclera plication and not muscle to muscle plication. So sutures are passed through the original insertion.
You can come in front.
So while passing the sutures, whether it's through the muscle or through the insertion, one has to be careful that one should not include the vessels in its in the bite. And now the muscle is folded on itself. So you have to make sure that the tucking is done properly. And conjunctiva.
So how many in the audience have seen or done plications? Few. So that is basically the one. Why is the restriction? Why most people don't want to do plications? Anybody from the audience?
So the horizontal muscle, a lot of cosmetic problems bulge over there.
Right. Yeah, in the supraoblique, it's mostly the tucking that is a standard strengthening procedure. The mainly the exposed part, we don't want a lumpy tissue. Although with time, it will gradually regress. But it will take a few weeks to months to have that lump disappear.
So yes, there are two major disadvantages of plication. One, of course, you when especially if you are doing medial rectus, there's a bulkiness over there at the site of at the incision site. So it is a cosmetic blemish, and the other disadvantage would be over the time it may relax, especially the muscle to muscle plication tends to relax over the time. So to conclude, the plication is definitely definitely an alternative, and it gives a similar surgical effect as good as resection for the treatment of both exo and esotropias, and it's definitely a viable option, especially in high risk cases.
And it's more commonly used for the vertical recti. I think we can do a plication of the inferior rectus, and it is very helpful many a times because it spares the circulation. So that is a major advantage of plication, that we can have the anterior segment circulation intact, provided you are doing a proper technique that you are not causing the vessel structure. I think Dr. Jitendra has to go in another session. We will have his talk now next. So he is going to tell us about the management of inferior obliques. Now, next to the horizontal procedures, recessions and resections, the most common procedure is inferior oblique weakening procedure. So how do we deal with it? We'll have from him.
I see. Can we have that? Yeah, I have no financial disclosures to make. We will quickly see the indications and then we will go to the surgical anatomy. And then we will quickly see some videos. So indications basically, if you narrow them down, it would be like whenever you see an infraoblique overaction, you should be doing it, you should be weakening it. So primary infraoblique overaction, supraoblique palsy, secondary infraoblique overaction with V patterns, combined with horizontal deviation if you find DVD with infraoblique overactions, secondary to supraoblique, can we switch off the lights? The contrast will be better. As a contralateral synergist to supraoblique suprarectus palsy in the other eye, so whenever there is an overaction, basically whenever there is an overaction, you can do it, but you have to do it judiciously. My talk is not only on indications, so we will quickly see them. Contraindications, when there is a V pattern, but you don't see an infraoblique overaction, when there is a large X pattern in a long-standing exotropia, sometimes there is an indication that you can do infraoblique surgery, but you have to do both the obliques. So if you have both the obliques overaction, you can go ahead and do it. And if there is an apparent overaction in craniofacial syndromes and you don't really feel that it is because of that, and more because of the change in the path of the muscles, you can leave infraoblique. So this is just a basic of anatomy. We will see surgical anatomy. So it is its origin is inclined posterior laterally. It is a very wide insertion. And if you have to find inferior oblique, it is just 10 millimeters posterior to the insertion of lateral rectus. So you can easily get it. And it is 5 millimeters from the optic nerve, so it is very close to the macula. In fact, there have been some studies where they have suggested that post-inferior oblique surgery, there has been some changes in the macula, and they have done OCTs of that. So the maximum muscle length available for recession is 12 millimeters. So you cannot, by any chance, recess more than 12 millimeters because it has a connection with inferior rectus and it has a neurovascular bundle. These are some of the points where you can do a recession. So Fink's recession, this is the Fink's point, Apt's point, Park, Elliott and Nankin. This is how you can recess. So you remove, this is for the anterior insertion of infraoblique. So this is MIMS anterior positioning. It is anterior to inferrectus, and F is the total anterior positioning. And there has been modified iliad and Nankin. So this is a very forgiving muscle, but you should be aware of the basic structures and where, what is to be done. We will be talking about that. And this is the most dreaded complication of infraoblique anterior positioning, or if it is not done judiciously. So what is anti-elevation syndrome? It is basically a co-contraction syndrome. So what happens is that inferior oblique starts acting as a depressor, and superior rectus is still acting as elevator. So when you tell the patient to look up, there is a co-contraction syndrome which forms because of the co-contraction of infraoblique and superior rectus. And this is an adverse outcome of anteriorization, especially if it is done unilateral. There would be a recurrent elevation in adduction, because when the patient looks in dextro or levo, the superior rectus is trying to the eye is trying to go up, and its agonist is infraoblique, and that pulls the globe down. So there's a co-contraction of the muscle, and excess anti-elevation and attempted elevation. This would cause a reduced palpable fissure width, as we see in Duane's retraction syndrome. When there's a co-contraction, there's a reduced palpable fissure width, and there will be a Y pattern. When the patient looks up, both the eyes will go out. So a selection of technique, you know, everybody has have their own technique. Everybody, it's quite debatable what people do in what circumstances. So I can just talk about a few things, like if there's a very small or a very minimal plus one infraoblique overaction, I normally do a Finks recession, because I feel that Finks does a very minimal effect in primary and very minimal effect in the secondary positions also. So if you have a very small plus one infraoblique overaction, you can do a Finks recession when you don't have much of a elevation in primary. What you have to do is you have to go 6 millimeter posterior to the lateral rectus and 6 millimeter inferior. This would be the anterior point of new infraoblique insertion. The posterior point can be 3 millimeters posterior to it or 4 millimeters posterior to it. You may leave bunching in this particular procedure, but in rest all the procedures where you are putting the muscle right next to inferior rectus, you have to do bunching of the muscle. So this is the posterior part of posterior end of infraoblique muscle. So that is regarding Finks recession. A 6-6 would give you an 8 millimeter of Finks recession. This we can do normally in very minimal infraoblique overactions. And if there is a moderate infraoblique overaction, but there is not much hyper in primary position, I would normally do a pure recession, which is Apton-Call recession, which they described in their landmark paper in AJO. It was published in 72. So what they have done is, what they have suggested a graded recession technique, and we have done a 4 millimeter, 4 millimeter from the inferior rectus insertion, and a 4 millimeter lateral to inferior rectus. So this gives a 10 millimeter recession, but no anterior positioning effect, as you would see in Park's recession. So this is a graded pure recession. And when you have slightly large overactions, what you can, what I do is, if you have a very large overaction in primary, I would go for a modified iliad Nankin. If there's a medium hyper in primary, I would go for Park's recession. And if there's a very minimal hyper in primary, but a very large overaction of infraoblique, not, you know, corroborating with the amount of deviation in primary, you can go for myectomy. Very rarely I do myectomy, so I have borrowed a video of myectomy. I don't have a video.
I think you will avoid myectomy.
Yeah.
I would say that myectomy is not really...
I'm not doing it, so I just... I won't show the video, because it is as such also a borrowed video. I've not done it for a long time. So this is the septum which was between inferior rectus and infraoblique. And this is right next to inferior rectus insertion, and this is we are putting the second part or the posterior part of infraoblique right in the line of inferior rectus, so that it follows the line of infraoblique as the infraoblique is. And I just have a couple of more videos. So very large overaction in primary position. Okay, no, this is what was somebody else's. Okay, so if you have a very large overaction in primary, very small, very large hyperdeviations, DVDs, you can do a anterior positioning of intraoblique. Mind you, as far as possible, you should be doing anterior positioning in bilateral cases and not unilateral cases. This is the last slide. So you have to pass the suture right next to inferior rectus, And the second part, this is the anterior end of infraoblique, and the second would be right next, only 1 millimeter temporal to the first this thing. So you have to do bunching of the muscle in both the videos. Both the videos are anterior transposition. This is total anterior transposition. I don't have a video of anterior nasal transposition, but so this is how you do a bunching and put both the insertion of both the ends of infraoblique as close to each other. So these are the two things. Pretty much finished. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jitendra. Use a razor which has an eraser behind it. Myectomy cannot be erased. That's a problem usually if you have an overcorrection after a myectomy or undercorrection. What do? So if you have a recession or an anterior positioning, and if you have a very severe, let's say 4+ or 5+ inferior oblique overreaction also, then also you can do an anterior nasal transpositioning. I think we will show a video of that, how you can do an anterior nasal transpositioning. It's again a very simple procedure. All the inferior oblique procedures are simple if you know. So just we'll show a video also of that. But myectomy, I think we'll avoid. So thank you, Jitendra. Adjustment. Recently, ISRO has adjusted 104 missiles in one, and we are capable. We have 22 people sitting in one Maruti 800, so we had the records. So adjustable procedures in history have been there and since 1941, and there are indications are when you have sensory deviation, central fusion disruption, when the fusion is not going to help you, when you have reoperations, vertical strabismus, when you have incompetent strabismus. Again, patients are having diplopia, and they are going to be demanding, be it paralytic or restrictive. And also, sometimes we are getting these cases of near-distance disparity. When the deviations are different from near and distance, if you do one procedure, you will get up having a strabismus in the other fixation. So what do you do? And then thyroid cases. The contraindications for adjustable procedures would be in the form of childhood, uncooperative apprehensive adults who will not allow you adjustment, high myopia, thin sclera, inferior rectus, which is having a progressive overaction of the reaction. So when the problem is complex, learn to adjust. Advantages are 70 to 80%, you can improve to 95%. This is an example showing you a sensory deviation which has been very well corrected. And what you have seen earlier with Digvijay showing you the recession procedure, there are slight changes that you need to make. As you see here, that what we are marking the position that we want to exactly do, the recession. But we'll pass our scleral bite, leaving a margin for our adjustment. And we will pass it coming towards the radial thing, coming towards the insertion. So both these bites, so we'll have first bite tunneling in this part and then in the insertion, rather than passing it circumferential. So that is one difference. Second difference is you will pass a silk suture between the sclera and the first knot. That's the other difference, which will help you in releasing this suture at the time of adjustment. The other thing is you are trying to see that the suture moves, and at the time of adjustment, there is little less resistance so that you don't have any problem. So you are going to tie a 1.5 knot so that you can release it at the time of adjustment, and you will make this suture, silk suture, as a loop. The other change is that you will make a bucket handle so that we don't have to depend upon the fixation forceps which may give up. And we will have a 6-0 vicryl suture tied at this point so that we can handle our adjustment at the time of adjustability. So these are the small differences in our technique. So what you see here is that it will look like this in the schematic diagram. You have passed. This is like a hemi hangback. You can have a full hangback also, but we prefer to have a hemi hangback because too much of hanging back can cause a forward creeping of the muscle. So it will not be as reliable in the long run. You can have two approaches in which this is passed as a 1.5 knot, or you can have a sliding noose technique. When to adjust? Usually we prefer to adjust about 5 to 6 hours after the surgery. In the morning we do it, and in the afternoon, evening, around 4:30 or 5, we will do the adjustment because the adhesions start forming in 5-6 hours. Some people have adjusted 24 hours or later also, but then you may have to use viscoelastic in order to prevent the adhesions. How much to adjust? Now, in exotropias, you want a little overcorrection, especially in adult exotropes. Less than 7 years, we will not do overcorrections in exotropia. But otherwise, you need to have about a 10 to 12, 11 prisms of overcorrection at the time of adjustment in order to have a proper correction. As you can see, this, there is an exo drift, and that comes to zero only if you have a overcorrection done. So when you are seeing at the time of adjustment, you will just see what is there. There is an exo, let's say, on your cover testing. So you will use these simple tools again. You will have a speculum, the xylocaine, tetracaine. You will use the fixation forceps, scissors, and a needle holder. That was the photograph of Professor Rosenbaum, who was my mentor in 2001. And I think this adjustable technique is thanks to him. So what you'll see here is that this is the suture, how it's coming at the time of prior to the adjustment. And this is after the adjustment, the eye has been shifted out. How do we do it? Now, what you see in the schematic diagram here is that the patient has been looking straight. And if we want to do a further shortening of the recession, then we can pull the globe and pull the muscle forward. It's easy. You can always pull the muscle forward. People say that having over recession is difficult. So earlier people used to do always an over recession and always pull up forward. So even if you had nothing, you would always have to bring it back to 1 millimeter in order to correct it. So that is not required. What we suggest is you do an optimal fixing of the muscle. If you need to recess further, you can. What you need to do is you hold the globe or the suture that we have tied and ask the person to look in that gaze. Now the muscle will contract. Let's say this is LR, lateral rectus. Ask him to abduct. What will happen? This will contract and the sutures are loose, so it can be further recessed. So you can always over recess. You can always bring it forward and that can be done easily. So you don't have to over recess these muscles. So, or a sliding noose technique is the other one in which you can do, but our preference is for the 1.5 knot. In the sliding noose, both these ends are coming here and you have tied a reverse throw suture which can be slided on this vicryl sutures. In children, if you want to do an adjustable, there is a technique described by Hakim et al. He has described a releasable suture. Or you can have a tandem technique in which you can have one suture which can be trimmed. This is a tandem suture in which there are two sutures. So one is having an extra recession and you can trim one of them in order to have. So this is basically two possibilities are there. You do not have too much of possibilities in this adjustment. Adjustable can be done. Can Faden be made adjustable? Yes, even Faden can be made adjustable. And this technique, I think, is very important for us to learn specifically for correcting the near distance disparities. I think we'll show you a video of this maybe in the VAST session in the evening if we don't have time now. There is the video VAST session. So even torsions, the superior obliques can be adjusted, the inferior obliques can be adjusted, any muscle can be adjusted. It is up to you how capable of adjustment you are, how much you can change to that. So this is something which you have to keep in mind. Now, I think Dr. Jitendra had already mentioned about inferior oblique procedures. Remember that we are also going to change the torsion. So I think you should now all be familiar that if you have an inferior oblique overaction, you have an extorsion. These are the two lines, the horizontal lines passing through the lower pole and either the middle or the 1/3, 2/3 junction. And this is definitely an extorsion. And after the inferior oblique surgery, this can be corrected. This schematic diagram shows you the various procedures. This is a normal inferior oblique. This is a sphinx. Now, sphinx is the most pure recession in which you are passing 6 mm and 6 mm here. In Parkes, what you're putting is, this is a Parkes procedure. And what we never try to collapse this end. We keep out 5 millimeter posterior suture so that we have a recession effect like that. This is a modified Illit Nankin method. And this is a pure anterior positioning, which is rarely done. So this is what I think even Jitendra had shown you. Now, do we have Dr. Rohit Saxena here? Or is he busy with some other session? So we'll talk about this maybe a little later. We will have the strengthening of the superiors, and Dr. Abhijit is here, ready with his talk. So can we have how we can strengthen the superiors? If it is done comfortably, then probably you can easily do it. Yeah. To trim one of them. And the tandem, I also don't like much because you don't have too much of options. You will only have two fixed options. It's like forced choice of two. So either you have Hillary or Trump. It doesn't work. You have to have more than two choices.
Discussing about the superior oblique strengthening procedures. So as we all know, the superior oblique paresis is one of the common form of paralytic strabismus which we encounter, in which the congenital superior oblique palsy is more common as compared to acquired. In congenital superior oblique paralysis, the inferior oblique overactions are the most commonly encountered, and less commonly are the superior oblique underactions. But the redundancy or the laxity of the superior oblique is still more common in the congenital form, and on the contrary, the extorsion or the excitotraction is common in the acquired form. So while choosing the superior oblique strengthening procedures, it should be very wisely chosen. So as we know, the anatomical insertion of the superior oblique is a fan shape. So the functionally, the superior oblique is divided into anterior one-third, responsible for the intorsion, and posterior two-third, responsible for the depression and the abduction. So the strengthening procedures are basically divided into the partial tendon tightening, the hyoidito, and full tendon tightening, the superior oblique tucking. So we'll discuss with the case-based approach. This is a 25-year-old male with complaints of diplopia since 9 months. He had a history of head injury. This is a preoperative photograph. Actually, it is a 9-gauge deviation where you can see there is no hypertrophy in primary position, minimal hypertrophia in alternate secondary gauges, and no inferior or minimal inferior oblique overaction. The most significant problem with this patient was the extorsion, which was very evident on the fundus photography and also on the double Maddox rod. The extorsion was around 15 degrees, and the alternate head tilt was positive in these cases. So what is the diagnosis? Was very simple. It was a bilateral post-traumatic superior oblique palsy. So how do you move ahead with these cases? So in Knapp's, in his landmark research, has told that we should weaken the muscle where the deviation is greater in that position. So in this case, the extorsion diplopia was the most common problem. So we have to tackle only that. So we did false modification of the hyoidito procedure. So in this video, you can see the superior oblique anterior and lateral transposition of the anterior one-third fibers of the superior oblique. So this is a schematic representation where only the anterior one-third fibers are anterolaterally transposed. Initially, we have to hook this with the superotemporal fornix approach, the superior rectus. Then the temporal border of the superior rectus is exposed, and the superior oblique is hooked through the same incision, where you can see. Projector. You can see the superior oblique is being exposed. Then we need to disinsert only the anterior one-third fiber and separate and disinsert. We don't need to pass the pre-placed sutures before disinserting, because that's the beauty of the oblique. We don't need to pass the sutures because they will not fall back. So we can easily pass the sutures after the disinsertion of the anterior one-third fibers of the superior oblique. We usually pass a 50 double arm 50 ethypon sutures, or we can use a Vicryl suture in that case also. So full thickness interlocking double arm bites are taken with the 60 Vicryl or 50 ethypon. So this is a false modification where we disinsert. In the classical hyoidito procedure, we do not disinsert. With the same incision, then we hook the lateral rectus, and the superior border of the lateral rectus is exposed. So this is the superior border of the lateral rectus exposed, and 8 mm mark is taken from the superior insertion. Then we pass when we fix the anterior part of the sclera at 8 mm, and it is transposed. The advantage of disinserting is that adjustable procedure can be done with the modified hyoidito procedure, and with the classical hyoidito procedure, it's the advantage is that it's a reversible procedure. Then we close it with the ATO Vicryl suture. So this is the classical hyoidito procedure, but only we separate and don't disinsert the superior oblique fibers. So you will not appreciate much difference between the post-operative and pre-operative photographs. Moving on to next case, this is a 13-year-old female. She had a head tilt, which is left side, since birth. The pre-operative deviation, you can see there is the right hypertrophy in primary gaze, which is increasing in secondary gazes to almost 25 diopters, and which is increasing in levodepression to almost 40 diopters in the gaze of the superior oblique. So what do you need to do in these cases? Again, the diagnosis is simple. It's a right eye congenital superior oblique palsy. So we need to do an exaggerated force reduction test for the superior oblique muscle in this case. If the superior oblique is tight, then we need to do the superior oblique tuck. Or if it is not, then we can do the inferior oblique weakening procedure. So initially we went ahead with the force reduction test for the superior oblique. So this is a schematic representation of superior oblique tuck, which is the full tendon tightening of the superior oblique tendon. So force reduction test is done with the help of single forceps of guidance method. You can see the globe is so lax, it can be moved, depressed. Now again the superiotemporal fornix incision is taken, superior rectus muscle is hooked. Underneath the superior rectus muscle, we separate the superior oblique fibers. You can see the intermuscular septum is then separated. Here one. And see the laxity of the superior oblique. You can, the superior oblique tendon can easily come out through the insertion. Now we have to pass 8 mm super mark, which is 50 double on ethibone suture is passed at the 8 mm, and then it is inserted through the base of the insertion, that is muscle to muscle. So here it is done in the case of scleral incision, muscle to scleral incision. So this is stuck. The FDT is again confirmed and it is found to be desirable.
So a line joining the two canthae should be your limit up to which you can tighten it. If you do more than that, you will be creating a Brown syndrome, which will be undesirable.
Yes. So this is a post-operative photograph where you can see the patient is ortho with only single procedure, and the alternate head tilt test is also negative in this case. So to conclude, the superior oblique interactions are less common, good preoperative assessment is important. Iatrogenic Brown is the most common complication associated with superior oblique tuck. The hyroidito is a safe procedure and does not correct the primary position deviation and does not generally limit the elevation in adduction. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhijit. He's working in Gwalior and we bless him for all the best. So, as you have seen, that superior oblique tightening when we want to do, it is when it is lax. Never do a tight muscle or a normal muscle also tucking. Never should be done. And the other thing which he was trying to show you was a Harada-Aito procedure. Classically, Harada-Aito procedure is done in cases in which there is a bilateral superior oblique palsy. And in these cases, you will find, what will be the features of a bilateral superior oblique palsy? Any of the fresh PGs, how do you detect a bilateral superior oblique palsy? Huh? Double Madox rod will show you, okay. What else? In double Madox rod, you are only measuring the extorsion. So the extorsion will be there even in unilateral superior oblique palsy, but in bilateral, it should be more than 10 degrees. Okay? Right. What else? A V pattern ESO with a head posture, usually a head down position, like a bull in a china shop, I say, no, a charging bull. So that sort of patient comes, then you have to be careful, and if especially after a head injury. So in these cases, you should be looking for a V ESO. If there is an ESO in the down gaze and he has a V pattern, you will not find much of hypertropia or hypotropia because it's bilateral. So vertical effect is being neutralized. So what you're seeing is mainly a torsion which is getting changed. So we will be doing bilateral superior oblique palsies, think only Harada-Aito procedure. So now we move on to the haves and have-nots, how we deal with. So what are the situation that we will be encountering? So we get cases in which there is a large angle exotropia, in which there may be, like this girl, when she presented to us, she had a very large 90 prisms of exotropia. We still thought that there would be some thing. So we did a CT. And CT also sometimes, surprisingly, does not help you. It shows that muscle is still there. So we did an intraoperative procedure thinking that we will advance or tuck the, plicate the medial rectus and recess the lateral rectus. But what we found was that there was no medial rectus. There was a medial rectus aplasia. You have already done a lateral rectus recession, maximally. And if you don't have a medial rectus there, what do you do? If you do a vertical transpositioning, you will have a problem of anterior segment ischemia. So in these cases, a good tool which comes to our hand is a Nishida's technique, in which we do not disinsert the vertical recti, but just put them, myopexy, the vertical recti, closer to the muscle which is absent. And then you can have good results after this. As you see here, she is having a straight eyes in spite of having a large 90 prisms of exo. And what schematically you will see is that the muscles have been transposed, as you can see, closer to the absent medial rectus. So this is using the 5 ohm ethibond sutures that will myopexy the muscle closer to it. So let's have the video of the Nishida's procedure. This is relatively a newer procedure because earlier it was described as So what you see here, that we will make a limbal incision. So we can see the missing muscle also. And this is the same case in which we had an absent medial recti. So this was done. We tried to hook. There was only a sheath, nothing there. So let's move forward. If you have already done the recession and you only find that there are two anterior ciliary vessels, namesake, coming there, and no muscle there. So you have to then change your strategy and go to the vertical recti. The whirl is what goes in your mind at that time when you are not having anything to do. But then I think I had met Dr. Nishida in Singapore in 2013, and he told me about this technique, which I found very useful. We modified it a little bit. What we are doing is that we are passing these ethibond sutures 8 millimeter away from the insertion of the superior and the inferior recti. So here now the inferior rectus has been, we have hooked, we have passed these sutures, and then we are going to bring them closer to the absent muscle. So we are sort of tenting the vertical rectus towards the missing muscle. So the vector forces of this vertical rectus will now contribute for both the vertical action and the horizontal action. But we will have to balance the vertical forces on both the sides. So we will also do the superior as well as the inferior rectus. Again, 8 millimeter away from the insertion, you are passing these 50 ethibond bites. While passing these bites, you have to be careful that you do not sacrifice or affect the blood circulation. So it's a very simple technique. I'll tell you, strabismus is very simple. You just need to know the basics and you can practice it to the benefit of the patients. So this is how it will be completed, and you will see that you can do a little bit of adjustment at this time to see that you have the eye in the center, and then close your limbal sutures. Is it clear? The other thing that we might have to do sometimes is the split VRT. Now, we want to still spare the blood circulation. So what you'll see here, the superior rectus has been hooked, and then we are splitting the fibers which are closer to the missing muscle. So in this case, it was the lateral rectus which was missing. So we have separated the lateral fibers on one side. Here, if it's possible, you can spare even the vessel which is over this lateral half. So 2.5 millimeter from the insertion, the 6-0 vicryl sutures are being passed. So we will have an inbuilt resection effect also to tighten the muscle which we are going to transpose. So about 2.5 millimeter away we have done, and then we are disinserting the muscle. And we are leaving the rest of the muscle there with this blood circulation. Now, the missing lateral rectus, in this case, it was a case of Duane's in which we had done a periosteal fixation. So we have now brought the superior recti, the lateral half, and tightened it as 1.5 knot so that we can adjust intraoperatively. Now the second part is the inferior rectus being hooked, and then we'll split, and again we'll have the 6-0 sutures passed. Disinsert and bring it close. Now, this is the conventional way of doing a split VRT. We can have a little more enhancement of this effect. So when we found that when we were doing this VRT and we were having undercorrection of the abduction effect, the Foster's sutures can be applied. What we are doing is that we will further vectorize the force in the side of the missing muscle, and we could do the Foster suture. But if we want to adjust, Foster sutures will not allow us to adjust. So the cross action technique, that means you bring the superior part on the inferior part of the lateral rectus and the inferior vessel fibers to the superior part, as I'll show you here. So what you see is schematically the diagram of, now this is again a case of a lateral rectus palsy. The upper pictures, do you have the laser light pointer? See, this is the esotropia with an abduction deficiency, and what we need to do is this lateral rectus, we need to spare. If you are not doing any resection, let the lateral rectus be there itself. We have taken out the lateral part of the superior rectus and the lateral half of the inferior rectus and brought it, the inferior rectus we have brought closer to the upper end and the superior fibers we have brought closer to the lower end. So this is the cross action adjustable split VRT. So advantages of the vectorization are there because this is going to increase the tension in the superior fibers, so it will bring much more effect. You don't have to put a Foster suture, but still it is adjustable, so you can adjust at 5 to 6 hours and get the proper correction of the six nerve palsy. So this is a very good technique which we had shown in APOS 2015. Another technique which is helpful in case of transposition is the split lateral rectus. You can bring it to the medial rectus side. That means if there is a third nerve palsy. Now in third nerve palsies, you can't do a VRT because the vertical recti are also involved as a part of the third nerve palsy. So what you need to do is use the lateral rectus muscle itself as an adductor. But you have to be careful in which cases can you use. If there is a very tight lateral rectus, you should not use LR to MR because it will cause a severe overcorrection. Either you will have to do an adjustable LR to MR then. Then again you bring it on this side and keep it on the adjustable sutures. Otherwise you will usually have an overcorrection esotropia. The ideal technique or indication for a LR to MR is, anybody from the audience, what is the, which will be the ideal situation in which LR to MR is most suited? The synergistic divergence cases, when the lateral rectus is getting its innervation at the wrong time. So you can, lateral rectus gets its innervation during adduction. So in those cases, you can use LR to MR very effectively, and this is how you can be correcting it. So the other thing which third nerve palsies which you can do is anchoring the globe itself. If nothing works, then what you can do is anchor this globe to the medial periosteal wall, and you can give him straight eyes in the primary position. So this is what we had described as a technique in which we can give a proper correction. The periosteal anchoring of the lateral rectus can be done, and then you can resect the medial rectus. That is another thing. So here we are doing a lateral rectus periosteal fixation, because if you recess a lateral rectus which is very, very tight, it will still have a exo because it's so tight. It's like a terrorist. If you just leave him again, he will strike back with vengeance. What do you need to do with a terrorist? Either do an extirpation, which many of the Westerners do. We are in India, we are not extirpating. We just isolate them and then put them in total confinement. So this is what we can be doing in these cases. I think we go on to the next part of the talk, that is chopping intelligently. We need to do the muscle surgery in a very accountable manner. And I think I'll just tell you a small anecdote. A ship was not working, and many engineers were called to rectify it. They used all their learning from the various engineering institutions, but they couldn't. Then they called a wise man. He went around, and he saw that what has to be done. So he asked for a tightening screwdriver, and he tightened the screw, and the engine started working. So he said, "How much is your bill?" He said, $1,000. The people said, "What? For tightening a screw, you want to charge $1,000? He said, "No, it's only $999 for finding out which screw to tighten and just $1 to tighten the screw." Strabismus is like that. It's a very simple surgery. You just need to find out which screw to tighten. First of all, you have to tighten your own screws. So in aberrant regenerations, we have situations which we have to think more intelligently. Now this is a case in which there is a third nerve palsy. There is a ptosis, but she has an aberrant regeneration. What happens in that? That when she looks on the other side, this ptosis gets corrected. So in order to correct this ptosis without the help of the oculoplasty surgeon like Dr. Ashutosh, what we can do is we can operate on the exot correction on the other side. This is how the aberrant regeneration look like, that you have a ptosis which gets corrected on looking on this side. So what you need to do is correct the exot deviation in the normal eye. It will like be like a fixation dures, and this will correct your problem. Now this is a case in with a girl who had a third nerve palsy, large ptosis, and we have corrected the exo, we want to do it. So we can again think and do. First of all, do an FDT. LR and SR we find are tight, so we can weaken the LR and the SR also. But we will find that still the problem is still there. So what you need to do is that you want to do a contralateral procedure and then give her this position in all the gazes. And it is possible. You just need to do a proper thinking of this. So this is what she was having earlier, and this is the final result. So this is just with the help of proper technique that you want to do. So the message that I would like to leave you with is that you have to chop intelligently. This is another interesting case. He had a bilateral exotropia. There was an alternating phase turn. And when we examined his eyes, there was such a large exo. As one would like to say, when he looks towards the right side, the left eye goes, looking London, talking Tokyo. So, and then not only that, can we go back? The other thing is happening when he looks towards the left side, the right eye actually dips down. So it is like looking Singapore and this is talking to Sydney. So this is not to be tackled by simple, easy techniques. So we also did a dynamic MRI in this case, and we found that on the dextro gaze, there was a lateral rectus of both the sides were getting innervation. They were showing increase in the width of this muscle. And on the levo gaze, the lateral rectus of the left side as well as the right inferior rectus are showing you increased cross-section, meaning that they are having more innervation. So we will have to tackle this little differently. And what we will do is that, so what we did in this case was, we have weakened the lateral rectus. We can do a lateral rectus to periosteal fixation. We can totally weaken that. And we can also transfix the inferior rectus, which is getting the extra innervation at the wrong time, to medial rectus. So identify which muscle is getting the innervation at what time. If during adduction, the inferior rectus is getting innervation, take out the inferior rectus from there and put it close to the medial rectus. It's like finding out the naughtiest boy in the class and making him the monitor. So this is what we have got in this case, that this is corrected. You can see here how this looks initially and how the eyes can look corrected. So this is in Canadian Journal, this time it's coming. So this is about the intelligent part that we are talking about. We have one, I think Rohit has come back. Yeah, so we have that thing which was missing. So we can have now his talk and then we can have the questions after that.
The superior oblique, all the various techniques that we can use. It is a rather sacred kind of a muscle because it looks in down gaze, as always sir says with humility, as something which we should not remove from our lives. So when we weaken the superior oblique, we should be very careful in what we are doing. So what are the indications when you would want to touch and weaken a superior oblique? So A pattern strabismus, where the A pattern is because of superior oblique overaction. So you can see an A pattern coming, the eyes are wide in down gaze, and because of bilateral superior oblique overaction. A Brown syndrome, which is a tight superior oblique, which does not allow the eye to go up and in, and an inferior oblique, primary inferior oblique over ipsilateral inferior oblique overaction. Superior oblique weakening procedures would be posterior tenectomy of the superior oblique, and expander or a chicken suture or a tenopexy, where you lengthen the tendon of the superior oblique, a translational recession, and a free tenectomy or tenotomy. So earlier superior oblique recessions was described, but the beauty of the superior oblique is its beautiful insertion, which is so wide and posterior. So they had described recessing it, but they found that that causes more problems because it changes the insertion of the superior oblique. It collapses the broad posterior insertion, makes it more anterior and nasal, and changes it from a depressor and abductor to an elevator and adductor. So it actually changes the primary action of the superior oblique. So superior oblique recessions primarily is not what we routinely follow. So then we had Predio Diaz describe the posterior tenectomy of the superior oblique, where this is the superior oblique, and these fibers are removed, leaving the superior oblique pulling just in the anterior 1 to 2 millimeters, which are responsible for torsion. So the torsional fibers are left behind, but the depressor and abductor fibers are removed. So this is a video of the posterior tenectomy of superior oblique. Superior temporal fornix, we make an incision. Obliques are better operated in a fornix incision because you're entering right next to the superior oblique. You don't have to make very long conjunctival incisions. And you access just adjacent to the lateral margin of the superior rectus. You first hook the superior rectus so that you can identify and separate the fibers of the superior rectus away from the underlying superior oblique fibers. So these are the fibers that you can see would be just underneath the superior rectus. Sorry for the slight decentration. They're pearly white in appearance, and you have to hook them from passing your hook, snugging the sclera. You have to hook them. You have to go and observe nasally to make sure that all the fibers, nasal fibers and posterior fibers, are removed, because that's the aim of the entire surgery, to remove the posterior fibers. The anterior fibers are removed. You can see that actually when you examine the superior oblique, there is a bend or a turn of the superior oblique fibers. So the anterior fibers are the torsional fibers, and then they, as it bends away in that direction, posterior and nasally, you remove those fibers. So now I don't often measure. I see for the turn of the inserting fibers, and I remove those. I make a split just there, and I remove these anterior fibers, which would be responsible for torsion, and keep them on the side, and remove the posterior fibers. So posterior tenectomy removes these fibers. About 8 millimeters of length you separate out. So that's the amount you cut, and this is the amount cut. So in a trapezoid fashion amount, and this is the remaining stump which we remove, and we remove that. So these are the fibers which I'll hold and cut from its insertion. And you can see only these anterior fibers are left, and the posterior fibers are removed. So these are the anterior fibers that are left. You can see these are the fibers. So this is posterior tenectomy of superior oblique, a very effective and a very useful procedure for primary overaction of the superior oblique. So you can see the marked superior oblique overaction is straightened up. The next was the silicon expander to lengthen the entire superior oblique tendon length, described by Wright. So basic purpose was to open up the superior oblique and cut it open and place a silicon expander in between. So here you can see the cut ends. This is the cut ends of the superior oblique where we are able to place the expander. And the limitations were that a silicon foreign body is introduced, and it can cause extrusion, can get stuck. So a non-absorbable suture was described to lengthen the superior oblique like this. And the problems are that it can act like, it can cause fibrosis and can actually scarring and pull it together, so you can have late undercorrections of the surgery. So this is the suture myopexy, or the lengthening of the tendon using the suture. So again, the process is the same. You hook the superior oblique completely. You have to make sure you have all the fibers. Again, superior oblique should be operated from the lateral side, even though it's a tight muscle or tendon we're looking at, but it's better that you operate onto the lateral side so that everything is underneath the superior rectus. You don't disturb the medial side of the tendon. So here you can pass the sutures. We use non-absorbable sutures because they have to stay there, and non-absorbable sutures are passed and on both sides. And depending upon the length you want, so you'll measure the amount of length that is required. And this is one side of the sutures, and the other side, just like you pass for recessing a muscle. So you've passed the sutures on either side, and then you place them onto the other side. So in a bit of a gap, we'll pass the sutures again. And the length of the suture is kept so to decide upon the lengthening you require. That can be intraoperatively adjusted. So after you make a tie, you make sure that your FDT is to the desired amount. So you can see this is the length. This loop will be the length of the length of the lengthening or elongation of the superior oblique. So I measure, suppose it is 8 millimeters that I'm looking for. So I make a mark so that that much amount of suture I left behind after I cut the superior oblique tendon. So similarly, on the other side of the loop, I will make so that you have both the lengths of the loop exactly the amount as you want them to be. And then you will cut the intervening part of the superior oblique tendon. So this is the second loop that we have kept, and that is the length of the superior oblique, which will be the lengthening procedure. Like I said, you can, before you make the final tie there, you can do an FTT intraoperatively to make sure that that is your desired amount. So we're passing the sutures on the other side, and we'll just cut the intervening superior oblique tendon. Again, I'm sorry, when you pull the eye, sometimes if you're not noticing, it goes out of the area of recording. So because that's where you pass, and I'll just show you how it gets cut in the middle. And this is the length that we will be having. So this is a 1.5 tie. We have not made a final knot, and we cut it in the middle. So that's how you've cut it, and the suture lengthens up. So you can use either the band expander or, so this is the case of a Brown syndrome. You can see that there is limitation of elevation. That's post-op. You can see here, you can see that there is a hypotropia which gets corrected when you operate. So this was the hypotropia and the absence of elevation and adduction that you can get corrected. And again, this patient had a face turn, which we could correct. And translational recession is also a procedure that has been described. Other procedures include anterior tenectomy of superior oblique, where in cyclotorsion without vertical deviation occurs. And although that's a very rarely performed procedure, we tend not to perform free tenectomies or tenotomies because they have rather unpredictable outcomes. So you decide how much you want to do and you get the outcome. So just as a conclusion, moderate overactions, a posterior tenectomy of the superior oblique. You have a severe superior oblique overaction, a tight superior oblique, or a Brown syndrome. You can use expanders or translational recessions. Both procedures have similar superior oblique weakening and reduction in the A pattern. However, more excyclotorsion by the translational recession. Important muscle and down gaze, and therefore weaken only when indicated. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rohit. So, weakening. For the mild to moderate, the PTSO is the best. It's a very controlled procedure. It weakens the abduction and the depression effect and saves that. But the other procedure I'm talking about is a loop tenectomy. So you can disinsert the superior oblique at the insertion side and hold it in your forceps and then tie a 5-0 ethibond suture and then have a hangback superior oblique recession. So this will give a controlled effect. So this is our choice usually in Brown syndrome, that when we can do an intraoperative adjustment. So we can pass these sutures, hang back the superior oblique, and then get a proper correction at the time. We can also do it as an adjustable procedure after 5-6 hours also. So all these things, and as we are evolving in strabismus procedures, we are getting more and more demanding patients, and we are getting more and more commanding surgeons. So I think we have to meet the demand of the patients and solve it in a more precise and definite way. So if there are any questions that we can have at this moment, we have a few minutes. Otherwise, I'll show you the video of the anterior nasal transpositioning. So I think this is a compilation of the inferior oblique procedures showing you how the anterior transpositioning can be done. But when we have a very severe inferior oblique overaction, a 4+, then we can do an anterior nasal transpositioning. So what we'll be doing in such a situation is that we are again having the same way, but now we have to bring the inferior oblique on the nasal side. So this is the inferior rectus which has been hooked. We have disinserted the inferior oblique past the sutures, which is there from the temporal side. You bring it, and remember, it is underside of the inferior rectus, the inferior oblique is passing. So you can get it back. It was going from the nasal side, and you are getting it back on the nasal side. So it will form like a J or a C. And then you will fix this inferior oblique 2 millimeters nasal to the inferior rectus. This is a procedure described by Stager, David Stager, and it's a very effective procedure, and you can do more and more weakening. You can bring it more and more closer to the medial rectus, and you can correct any amount of superior oblique overaction, and the beauty is it is still under your control. So you can always revisit and correct it. So that is the beauty of the weakening procedure of Stager. And we have used many times this procedure as a secondary procedure. We have got cases still more stronger. So all these are in your armamentarium that you will have to think and do.
So, but yes, you would not touch the other eye.
No, why should you touch the other eye? If you have a DVD in this eye, you have inferior oblique overaction, you just do this inferior oblique total anterior positioning. The other thing is, if you have a DVD without inferior oblique overaction, that is to be tackled never by inferior oblique. I have seen people who have done inferior oblique anterior positioning in cases with DVD without inferior oblique overaction, and what should happen? If you think logically, what should these people have? The DVD may be corrected, but they will have a pattern. They will have, in the down gaze, they will have a divergence being created. So I think a lot of, there is a system in the madness of the strabismus. You need to do only when it is required. If you weaken an inferior oblique when it is not there, you will have a superior oblique problem coming in. So you'll have a superior oblique overaction, and then you'll have an A pattern. And down gazes, even a slight exo is very irritating. He says, I can't go down the stairs, I'll have a problem.
Thank you, sir.
So any other question? Any problems that you have faced, any of you in particular situations, or anything that you would like to say that you have done something different? I always want to have some new ideas from the people. Anybody? Yes, ma'am. Dr. Harsha Bain is there.
Are we supposed to take the affected eye first by recession and resection for the large exo that the patient is having, and the residual exo and aberrant regeneration afterwards in the fellow eye?
No.
We can directly go.
You directly do the normal eye first.
Okay.
Because you will need to do a large amount of supramaximal recession.
Mm-hmm.
You want, as Jampolsky has said, fixation durus. You want the innervation to shift in such a manner that it can lift the ptosis. So you want a large amount of innervation to come in to the muscle which is otherwise not getting the innervation. So you may have to do something like a 12 mm of LR recession and a resection of 6 mm of MR. So if you have, let's say, a 50 prisms or 60 prisms of exo, it will be corrected. If you have more than this, then you can do the either in the same sitting, the lateral rectus which was there. But mind you, if there is a tight FDT, you need to address to this.
Okay.
If you find that the lateral rectus in the third nerve palsy eye is tight, you need to recess the lateral rectus first of this eye and then do the contralateral procedure.
Otherwise, directly the fellow.
Otherwise, directly do on the other eye, as you saw in that girl.
Are
then only the contralateral.
Is it easy to convince the patients in those cases, if we can?
I think that is true, that you will have to. If it's not easy, even in patients who are not having aberrant regenerations, they say that my amblyopic eye needs to be operated.
Hmm.
And why should you operate on the other eye when you have a residual?
Right.
So you have, let's say, 90 prisms, and one eye is amblyopic, you have corrected maximum, you only get a correction about 55-60 prisms by two muscle surgery. So you have a residual of 30 prisms. And many times these cases will be referred to me as a residual thing. So I have to convince them that, look, this is there. The main hitch they have is that their vision should not be affected.
Yeah.
So you have to be more commanding. That yes, I assure you that your vision in the normal eye will be preserved. You do not want to do anything at that time in order to, sometimes you have done an FDT, you have created a hemorrhage. The patient is going to run away in the evening. So never do these procedures which will create problems. Either you have a non-hemorrhagic technique of holding the forceps, like Pierce-Hoskins forceps, when you are doing this assessment. So you need to bring up the confidence. And I will say, always put yourself in the place of the patient.
Yes.
How would you feel? I became a better doctor and a surgeon after I became a patient. When I was hospitalized for 4 months, then only I learned my best doctory, I think. So that is what you have to put. You put yourself, what will be your questions, your queries? And then you say, look, if I was there, I would also have these questions. But we can answer these queries and we will see that you are corrected.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yes, doctor.
While assessing the inferior oblique muscle, from where at
Okay, I think it's a very good question you are asking me, because there are people even in our country who are passing sutures before disinserting the inferior oblique. You don't have to trouble or struggle that much. You can easily disinsert the inferior oblique first, hold it in your fixation forceps, and then pass the sutures. Inferior oblique or superior oblique, both are having anterior insertion origins, and they are being inserted posteriorly. So even if they slip, they will only slip forwards. So you can never lose an inferior oblique, even if you have not passed sutures prior. So don't struggle to pass sutures in situ. You can disinsert the muscle, hold it in your forceps, and then pass your sutures. Was that your question?
What should be the point for disinserting the muscle? Because we cannot go all up to the
No, you need
insertion.
To do all up to the posterior most fibers. Only thing you have to be careful about is that when you are going posterior, you leave about a 2 millimeter, 2.5 millimeter extra stump, so that you do not pinch the sclera in the vicinity of the macula. Right? So that's what you use your curved scissors, and you will have a 2.5 millimeter stump behind. But you need to take care of the posterior most fibers. In fact, remember, the posterior fibers are the ones which you want to weaken. For an inferior oblique overaction, it's the posterior fibers which are doing the mischief. They are causing the elevation and they are causing the abduction. If you leave the posterior fibers, you will have an inferior oblique overaction on your head. So always take care of this, that you take care of the posterior most fibers in when you want to weaken the inferior or the superior oblique.
So my second question after your answer is that what should we do after a recurrent inferior oblique overaction or a residual?
That's what I said. That if you have, first of all, you need to do your planning beforehand. If you have a very strong inferior oblique overaction, a 4+, then if you do the Fink's procedure, you will fail. If you do a Park's procedure, also you will fail. If you do inferior oblique anterior positioning, also you are likely to fail if it's a 4+ inferior oblique overaction. So what you will do at the first instance, I would do a Stager's procedure, anterior nasal transpositioning, which is going to take care of a 4+ inferior oblique overaction. Even if it comes secondary, I would do the same. I will do a Stager's procedure and weaken the inferior oblique to my satisfaction.
Sir, if a patient has been operated from outside, let's say, and we don't know what the primary procedure has been done,
yeah,
and there is a residual inferior oblique overaction, so, sir, in that scenario, can we go and trace where the inferior oblique
is? I would really, when one of the messages which I would like to convey to all of you, please maintain your records and pass it on to the patient as a discharge summary. It will be good for you as well as for your subsequent surgeons, whosoever is doing. Never be shy of that. Make your records and pass it on, that what you have done. Otherwise, the next surgeon will have to explore and then see what is there and then decide on the table. Yes, Dr. Sharma. Which situation? In Stager procedure, we are bunching it 2 millimeters. Within 2 millimeters, we have to bunch it. We don't want too much of that. And it is as it becomes very strong. At times, I have got a case being operated ANT and I had to undo it. It was done by another surgeon, and I found it was overcorrected, over weakened. So I had to undo it, and then. So that's why I'm saying. But if you have an eraser behind your razor, it's fine. You can guarantee the best results. So I think we have. Yeah.
For the inferior oblique anterior.
Anti elevation, of course, you'll have. Anti elevation is the. Side effect which is there. So, you want to use that side effect for DVDs.
Yes.
If you want to avoid an anti-elevation effect, you do not bunch. Then you have to put the posterior sutures 5 millimeters behind.
Okay.
Always. So, as a modified illet and nankin that we have tried to mostly use in 2+, 3+ inferior oblique overactions, never do a total anterior positioning. Always do the first suture is close to the lateral border of the inferior rectus. The second suture, as you saw, was along the lateral border of the inferior rectus, 5 millimeters behind. It takes a little more effort, but then you ensure that the inferior oblique is still working as an inferior oblique and not as an anti-elevator. Yes? Good? Exactly.
If it is any DVD, then we choose inferior oblique anterior transposition.
No. I said any DVD without inferior oblique overaction, never do the inferior oblique anterior positioning.
Any DVD with inferior oblique overaction, but should we
choose the procedure depending upon how much amount
yes.
of DVD is there?
Suppose you have an asymmetric DVD and with a bilateral inferior oblique overreaction, then you can choose to do a 2 plus station for the inferior oblique anteropositioning in the eye which is having more DVD, and you can have just the inferior oblique anteropositioning in the other eye. Okay? So you can do. You can see how much is your requirement and do it. That is the fun and the pleasure of doing strabismus surgery. You can do controlled procedures as per your requirement. So I think I'm very, very happy that all you young people are taking interest, and that is the future looks bright for our children. Thank you all.